within the earliest foundation stage, within the early learning goals, communication, language and literacy has to be assessed in English. Therefore, we need to make sure that we give the children all the support and provision necessary in foundation stage to ensure that they're assessing what they can do rather than what they don't know. And we decided we needed to do some work with some target schools in the city to ensure that children were being assessed accurately and being allowed to demonstrate what they did know, knowledge and skills that they had in their home language as well as in English, so that all children would then achieve their full potential going through school. But there is a danger that that underachievement at early years foundation stage could follow them right through school up to GCSE level. So it's vital that we get that assessment process right from the very beginning for all our pupils. Good practice in early years foundation stage would promote the use of home language learning to support children in making progress in school. All the research shows that children learn better through the use of their home language. We have added in there as part of our guidance here in Leeds that children can show evidence of listening to others speaking in English by their body language, stillness, facial expression, pointing, correct action, etc. A non-verbal response or a response in home language is sufficient to show evidence of meeting the expectations of this early learning goal. So the listening has to be done in English, but the response doesn't have to be in English. So there are ways of looking at how those assessments are made to make sure that we're giving the child every chance to show their true potential in this early learning goal. So trying to make that clear for everybody. I'm going to give you a couple of minutes to have a look through the specific guidance that we've added for each early learning goal there, and to chat to each other about whether you agree or disagree with the guidance we've given, and trying to ask you some questions, to ask some questions as well. So if you'd like to take out this next handout, you'll see some of those examples there. I'd like to draw your attention to a couple of them. For example, on page 7, there was an observation of child A, who arrived in our class in October from India. She came to school speaking no English, but was very confident in her first language, Hindi. She was able to speak to bilingual staff who spoke Punjabi and Urdu, who were able to communicate with her. The children were listening in class to the story Giraffes Can't Dance. Child A sat and listened to the story with a large group of children. She put her hand up every time the teacher asked a question, and she was able to understand and respond to simple questions. Throughout the story, she was able to follow the story correctly by looking at the pictures and listening to the narration. She smiled every time she answered a question correctly, so you're seeing the communication through expression there as well. Her responses were often 1 to 3 word phrases. The story lasted for 15 minutes and Child A was totally engrossed in the story throughout, so her listening and attention was good. She displayed emotions centred on the story, smiled when the giraffe could dance and frowned when he had fallen over. So again, she showed by her body language that she understood the story. You can see then questions asked by the teacher and the Child A's responses, which are just in 2-word phrases mainly, or 1 or 2 word phrases. Later on, the teacher, who was able to communicate with that child in home language, asked her those questions again in home language. And you can see the difference in the depth of response that child was able to make. We were able to gather from that home language questioning far more information about how competent that child is in listening and understanding and also in speaking. So it's a real powerful piece of evidence to show how much home language can support learning within the curriculum. So, in terms of children learning new words, there's some wonderful work done by two speech and language therapists. I was very lucky to go on a course they delivered in Leeds a couple of years ago, and not from Leeds, Stephen Parsons and Anna Brennigan. And the course they run is called Word Aware. And it's a fantastic course. I follow them on Pinterest. I stalk them, as we say, and they come up with fabulous ideas on there quite regularly as well. And they talked on that course about the fact that children need, when they're learning new vocabulary, many, many hooks of understanding to help them to retain that new vocabulary that they're learning. Okay? They need to know what the word looks like. They need to know what the initial sound is, how many syllables in the word, what the word means, what category it's in, what it sounds like in a sentence. There's an infinite number of ways in which you can explore new words. One of the ways we look at them are word studies. Again, this is from the Children's Speech and Language Therapy Service, part of their toolkit. So here are some of the questions they ask about new words to help children really understand it. What is it made of? What shape and size is it? What letter does it start with? Where would you find it? What colour is it? What does it feel like? What is it a type of or category of? And what do you do with it? Obviously, some questions are more applicable to some words than others, and you have to tailor the questions to the actual words that you are studying with the children at the time. We have found this approach really successful in Leeds in helping children to understand, retain, and most importantly, use that new vocabulary in their speaking and in their mark making themselves as well. So here are some examples from settings in Leeds of word studies. And so you can download that from the Leeds Speech and Language Therapy site as part of their toolkit. So here's one done around the number 11. So we've got some objects, we've got some unicorn, we've got the word written down, we've got what the word looks like. Okay? So that was exploring the concept of the number 11. This one is on the word of the week, large. So it's got one syllable, and it's broken down into its phonetic sound there. What does it make me think of? So some children said a princess tower, that's very large. A cow, or an elephant, they're very large. Like, say it in a sentence, and these are the sentences the children said, which we wrote down, and then I have used the word, and we've got some evidence of children using that from the writing corner in their own provision area in school as well. So that's another example of a word study to develop children's understanding around a new word. One of the things we noticed going into nurseries and reception classes that early years practitioners are brilliant at labelling everything, but oftentimes those labels were mainly just nouns. And we know that sentences are made up of nouns and verbs and adjectives and prepositions, etc. So we encourage staff to start bringing in some other word classes as part of their labelling system within the setting to help children to understand and be able to put more words together to make phrases and sentences. So here we've got an example from one of the areas of provision where we've got lots of verbs. And we took pictures of the children themselves in doing the actions so that it made sense and they could understand those. And that helped them to be able to describe what they were doing in that area of the nursery at that time.